When we analyze circuits that contain op amps, we typically neglect the current that goes into either of the two pins of the op amp. We normally just assume that the op amp, in other words, has an infinite input impedance. In this video, I'm going to show you how you can sort of correct for the fact that the op amp is not really perfect. Of course, we know that both of the input pins of the op amp are going to draw a little bit of current from the circuit. We're going to look at the effect of that current on the output voltage in some typical amplifier circuits. First, let's define what we mean when we say input bias current. First of all, the reason it's called a bias current is because an op amp contains transistors. You need to supply a certain amount of current to the base of a bipolar junction transistor in order to put it into the forward active region. In other words, it's impossible to completely eliminate the current required by the source circuit. An ideal op amp would have a bias current of zero on both pins. With an amplifier, there might be small differences in the true currents drawn from the source along these two pins. But for the purposes of our discussion here in this video, I'm going to assume that these two bias currents are equal to one another. In other words, I can define IB1 as just IB, and I can define IB2 as just IB. Or, in other words, I can just say that the bias current is just the average of these two currents flowing into the two pins. Ideally, again, that current should be zero, but if it's not zero, what effect is it going to have on our circuits? We're going to be looking at these two circuits because these are probably the two most common circuits that use op amps, the non-inverting and the inverting amplifier. Again, we usually assume that this current is zero. Let's label our output voltage in both of these circuits. I'm just going to call it VO. Using the principle of superposition now, I want to isolate the effect of the bias current on the output voltage. Therefore, I'm going to apply a source of zero. In other words, I'm going to ground the input pin. If you look at these two circuits closely now, you might realize that the circuits are exactly the same. Look at the non-inverting pin. It's just connected to ground. You might also note that we have a resistor R2 applying negative feedback. That's true for both of these circuits. We then have a resistor R1 connected to ground at the inverting pin. That's what we have on the left side as well. Since both of these circuits are identical, I can apply the same analysis to both of them, and that's what I'm about to do. But before I start, I want to insert one extra resistor into these circuits. Let me show you. I'm going to call the resistor R sub B, and I'm going to attach it to the non-inverting input. I'm going to do that in both of these circuits, so the circuit diagrams are still identical for both of these amplifiers. The reason why I'm putting that RB there is because that's the resistor that I will later use in order to correct the problems with the bias current. Without that resistor, it will be impossible to eliminate the IB from the formula of the output voltage. My goal for both of these circuits, or for one circuit if you will, is to just find the output voltage in terms of IB. Once I found out what it is, I can use the resistor R sub B in order to counteract that effect. You'll see what I mean. Let's get started here with the derivation. I've included the resistor RB here in the circuit diagram, and I've labeled the bias currents I sub B. I've labeled the currents I sub 1 going through resistor R1 and I sub 2 going through resistor R2. I've labeled the voltage here V sub minus, and I'm labeling the voltage here at this pin V sub plus. Let's first sum the currents at node V minus. Using the Kirchhoff current law, we know that currents in equal current out. Let's now use Ohm's law to find both of these currents. For I1, we have 0 volts on the left and V minus on the right. The voltage drop is across R1. Then for current I2, we have V out on one side, and then following the current, we have V minus on the other side, and that voltage drops across R2. Because of the negative feedback and because we expect operation to be stable, we can see that V minus should also equal V plus. We can also apply Ohm's law across resistor RB. We can see that V plus is minus IBRB. The minus sign is there because, in a sense, the current's flowing the wrong way through the resistor, from ground up to a voltage rather than from a voltage down. Let's now take this expression and substitute it into our equation over here on the left. Minus V sub minus is IBRB. We again have minus V minus over R2, so this is just IBRB, and this is all equal to IB. I'm going to isolate this term on the left of an equation and put everything else on the right. Every term contains IB, so I'm going to factor that out when I rewrite the equation here. Going back for a moment to the previous slide and recalling our goal, we were trying to find the output voltage in terms of our non-zero bias current IB. I mentioned that I inserted the resistor R sub B because it would be important later, but first let's see what the answer would be like without it. In both of these circuits, if I remove RB, it's effectively saying RB equals zero. If we rewrite this expression and substitute RB equals zero, then I wind up with VO over R2 is just IB, or equivalently, the output voltage equals R2 times IB. It's impossible to eliminate the effect of the bias current on the output voltage. If I require a particular gain in my amplifier, then R2 has to be tuned. However, if I change R2 and I have a fixed bias current, then the output voltage is going to depend on it. It's impossible, in other words, without adding something else to the circuit, to eliminate the effect of the bias current. Now, let's assume that we don't have an R sub B equals zero. What would then happen? If we want the output voltage to be zero, I can make this expression equal zero. If I force this to be equal to zero, then what happens? Let's write it out and solve for R sub B. Let's multiply everything times R1, R2. Let's now put all the terms with RB on the left side of an equation. We now have an expression for R sub B. If I choose an RB that's equal to what the formula tells me right here, then I can eliminate the effect of the bias current in my amplifier. You might notice this formula as being R1 in parallel with R2. I now know how to make a better inverting amplifier and a better non-inverting amplifier. Let's look at my new versions. This improved inverting amplifier will give me the same gain, minus R2 over R1, but because of the presence of the R bias, it's going to eliminate the effect of the bias current on the gain. Of course, that's provided that you choose the correct bias resistor. We've already found the formula for that. Let's also take a look at our improved non-inverting amplifier. You might notice the gain of our non-inverting amplifier. It's exactly what we expect, but with the presence of the bias resistor, we're going to be eliminating the effect of the bias current. Of course, that's provided that you choose the correct bias resistor, which is given by the formula here. What we've looked at in this video is the effect of the bias current on the output voltage for both the inverting and the non-inverting amplifier, and I've shown you how to correct for it. Of course, the bias current might affect the operation of other amplifiers as well, but using techniques like this, you can at least improve upon the output in such cases as well.